What's going on, everybody? Welcome to another edition of Kaiju Live Chat slash Review. This is kind of a new one. Never done anything like this. Thank you so much to David for joining us. I'm very excited.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. Really, really good. Really good. Thanks for having me. I'm always willing to talk about Bandai figures, the figures that really got me started in my collecting journey, to be honest.
Same. So what was your first one? What was the initial hook?
So I never even knew this stuff existed. I was living in New Jersey at the time, and I used to take the train into the city to do some exploring and hang out with some friends. And before I met the friends, I would hang out in the West Village, and there was this one street. I'm sure you know the West Village because you're from that area, right? You're a native New Yorker.
At that time I was
you were young.
I'm old. Youngest, yeah.
You were a kid.
My dad's anyway, in the chat. He might know what you're talking about.
This is like we're talking like late 80s. Okay, I had just graduated college, discovered that I absolutely love New York City. Anyway, Bleecker Street used to be the shit back in the day. Okay, and there was one store in particular called Children of Paradise, and they had a lot of Godzilla stuff in the window, model kits, toys, vintage stuff, and Bandai figures were some of the main things that they had. And I would always look in the window. It seemed to be always closed when I got there because I was usually there later on. But there was also a shop called Kim's Underground Video, which you probably remember. And it was on Bleecker Street, a couple doors down from Children of Paradise. And I strolled in there and sitting on the cash register, they had this guy. If I can get him out, they had this guy. The 1984...
Nice.
Godzilla, right?
The classic.
And the price tag around his neck was $5. If I was smart, I would have bought all three. But I was poor and I only had enough money to get one and enough money to get my ass home on the train. So I did buy one. And there's another part to the story. So behind the counter on the shelf where some of the videos were displayed, there was the 1988 Showa Bandai King Ghidorah with the tag on it. And just for curiosity, I asked how much those were. And he said, oh, those are $25. And I thought to myself, ooh, who would pay $25 for that plastic? And boy, did I eat those words many times after the fact. And that figure actually became my holy grail trying to find one. I could not find one. It was elusive after that. But yes, so that was a very long way to tell you that my very first figure was from the Godzilla collection was the 1984 Bandai. Awesome. How about you, AJ?
I'm actually ashamed. I didn't put him close enough. Give me one second. I'm going to slide away.
Hold on. Slide over. I'm going to grab the tag that just fell on the ground too. So this is the actual tag from the figure. So I always take my tags off and I display them next to the figure. I don't like them dangling on there for the most part, so that's the way I work with it. I always save them and put them in these little plastic baseball card sleeves or whatever you want to call it. So
I did the same thing, especially on the plastic tag ones, where they're, I don't know, people feel differently about tags now, it seems.
There's especially a lot of
on the Kaiju Live show, the auction show. A lot of people don't care about tags at all. Which if you've ever seen, there's always this funny thing between my dad and I is like I'm old school in the sense of like everything has to be mint in box. So you know, my dad's always like, "Oh, take it out of the box, take it out of the bag," and I'm like, "No, we don't do that. There's none of that." So the same thing with tags. A lot of people, you know, we'll have it tagged on the show and then they get it and they cut the tag off. And I'm like, okay, whatever. But you know, different strokes for different folks. So that's this right. Is mine. My original Gigan is what got me hooked. We were visiting my grandma in Pennsylvania. I was probably, 8, 9 years old, and there was this mall that happened to, I believe it was actually in almost like Jersey. So I remember my uncle actually got like really pissed. We were driving all the way out there to go to this gigantic mall that was in PA. And they had this one like comic book store and in there, and they had all these Bandai figures. And I always really liked Gigan. Gigan was really cool. So this was my first one.
It's a good way to good place to start.
And then it was basically all downhill from there, or uphill, depending on how you want to go about it. And my dad and I got hooked, and we, you know, Bandai became our, you know, I've always had like, you know, the Imperial, you know, Imperial was probably my first Godzilla Kong action figure back in the day. I think I even made a, I might even still have the camcorder recording of this Godzilla Kong movie that I made with an Imperial, and I think it was the 73 Kong plush.
Oh my goodness.
Like a short movie that I made when I was like, I don't even know, 10, and I have them like battling in front of a fish tank, you know, totally.
You definitely have to find that and post it. People, that's gold. Stuff like that is gold. People love that stuff.
Total super real stuff.
So let me ask you this. How much did you pay for your Gigan? I mean, mine was $5.
Dad, you in the chat? How much did you pay reasonable. For that guy, gang? I didn't pay anything. it's probably in the same realm, honestly. Maybe 10, if it was that. But yeah, this is like, you know, when they all first came out. So we're gonna. I know we called it the evolution of Bandai. So a quick overscope of what we're trying to do here. This is gonna be part one because me and David agreed we could be here for 5 hours, and I don't know if that makes for a great sit down block time, so we're pretty much going to cover all of the original 80s stuff into basically like 95, all the 8-inch stuff, and then part two is going to be like the 6-inch line, Bandai Museum, Bandai Premium now, which is, you know, they're coming back in full force with some incredible figures.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of our scope here.
No, that's cool. And I just want to put it out there, you know, AJ and I do not confess to be experts on Bandai figures, but we're just two collectors who were, you know, want to give a little chat about how we, you know, bought our Bandai figures and kind of reflect on that a little bit instead of like being like showing you each one and giving you the dimensions and this and that. So if that's what you're looking for, yeah, probably not going to do too much of that, but it's just going to be a fun chat. And I should start by saying that the original Godzilla collection started when Toho first announced that they were going to do the Return of Godzilla film, and Bandai immediately started to produce Godzilla figures in 1983. And that line, the Godzilla Collection line, aka the standard figures, went from 1983 to 1995. And I think AJ is going to show you now the very first that Bandai has done.
So this was, as far as Godzilla goes, the first, I know I just said I don't open boxes, but can't really see him behind there. So this was the first Bandai Godzilla figure ever made. And this came in a box, and it's actually a rubber figure.
That's so cool.
Looks very, you know, Mosugo G64, you know, total got some little posability in there, but total rubble figure. Do not, if you have one of these, don't let your dog see it. So yeah, this is the original one from 83. Lucky enough to still have the box in, you know, fairly good shape. I mean, even the window is still, you know, intact. So that's awesome.
That is an awesome piece. And that was one of the pieces that the store Children of Paradise on Bleecker Street had. And it was way out of my price range. Even back then, that one was pretty expensive. And I'm talking like maybe like 1988, 89, like around that time is when I started to buy the stuff. But that figure, I've never seen it in that great condition because, like you said, the rubber sort of doesn't hold up well over time, and the window on the box usually gets kind of messed up. So that's a great piece, AJ. I'm stoked that you have that. That's cool.
And right now, and then that was it. That was pretty much their experimentation. They were like, these rubber figures, and we're done. So that was a one and done. And I believe you have a few of the next ones up with the originals.
Yes, the original. So the next one I got was actually from Forbidden Planet. And a lot of you who were living in the New York area at the time know that Forbidden Planet was just like this amazing comic book toy shop. And that was sort of over on Broadway, a little bit further east. So the next one was the 1964 Godzilla. And really a bit more stylized, I'd say, than even the 84, and definitely the larger scale, the 9-inch scale. For some reason, they decided to make the 84 smaller than the rest of them that came out after. But I think that's kind of cool, and it adds to the coolness of it. So yeah, the next one I got at Forbidden Planet was this guy, and that came with a tag too.
To show you guys. No, keep going. Yeah, that's the original tag.
And there's this tag, the original tag. And it always made me crazy because they always put the wrong Godzilla on the back of the tag.
I know.
I mean, they put a 67 on there, and it was like, what's
the 84
going on?
At least has both, right?
The 84 does have both. The 84 has the Cybot.
Cybot on the back.
And then on this one, it just has actually, Cybot's on both sides.
Yeah, he's actually, I think he's the only one that's accurate throughout.
But, I mean, the front. I guess this is what you consider the front. It does have the 64 Godzilla on. But anyway, I was just excited to see a Godzilla figure of any sort of reappear, because real quick, you said you did the Imperial. That was your first. I started with the Aurora Glow Godzilla in the mid-70s. And pretty much for most of my childhood, that was the only Godzilla figure that I had, because there wasn't much available. I never did get the Mattel Godzilla or the Rodan. And I never did get the Imperial, because even back then I was like, this thing sucks. Sorry. And they used to have it at KB Toy and Hobby Shop. It was like right by the cash register. And I was like, this is supposed to be Godzilla. I don't think so. Anyway, there was a span between like maybe like 1975 and 1988 where I bought nothing. I had nothing in my collection. And the Aurora was in a box in my mom's house, the model kit. So when I first discovered these new toys, that is what really – I guess that is the beginning of my collecting journey, because they're pretty realistic, slightly stylized. But for the most part, considering what was available, they were pretty realistic. And the only other thing that you could get were the early garage kits. And some of the Billiken kits started to come soon after. But it was pretty much all that there was up until – 1983, when Bandai started this line. Mm-hmm. So that's my journey and how I started.
I also had, it was the Imperial, and then there was the, I don't even remember who made this. It was supposed to be Godzilla, but it wasn't. It was the remote control. It wasn't a remote control. I don't remember it being, but it walked and the smoke came out of his mouth. He was kind of like green with some yellow highlights. I think he was called,
it the
like,
Mattel? It wasn't the Mattel.
No. It wasn't the Shogun Warriors, no. Man, Dad, are you watching? Do you remember that? That was one of my first two. He was really cool. Eyes lit up, roared, but
I don't know.
Honestly,
that
don't remember. He wasn't even called Godzilla, but to me it was Godzilla. So you brought up the 64 figure. So this is the one thing that kind of can drive completionists crazy, like myself. So he had the original, which was released in 84. And then they also have the same, with a slightly different paint app. Going in front of you. Slightly different paint app. But then this is called the alt tag. And then as being consistent, it's the 62 on the tag for whatever reason. There's a couple ones that have... alternative tags. We'll get into that in a little bit. And then
absolutely.
So that's the reissue. And then they came out with the 89 damn tag. Again, they reissued it a third time. So there, and this one had more of a darker like black paint app, as you can see. And then the highlights are always all different. Like I've seen some of these where he's got his little belly here, like all the way. Yeah. So like you can just
These are
all hand painted, right? All the original ones.
That's
why they're all just kind of like.
Somebody in the chat might know the answer to that, but yeah, look, you can see that they're very different.
Yeah. So, but again, you can tell And so, like, if you know what you're looking for, you can tell the difference. And obviously, the tag always helps. So that's the 64. Oh, Big Rex. Someone that's, yes, it was Cold.
That's right. Big Rex. Yep. Now I kind of do remember it. And it was unlicensed. And I think they just sold it at like regular toy shops, like KB and that kind of thing. Toys R Us.
And then what's up next? What, 62, I believe?
Well, that would be logical. But the 62 was another one that eluded me for the longest time. I had a bootleg 62, and I hate bootlegs, and I'm totally not a fan of bootlegs, but I was desperate to have one. And in somewhere in New York, I think it was close to Bleecker, there was a fashion shop that had a clothing store, and the owner was Japanese, and he had a bunch of Bandai figures on display, not for sale. Believe me, I asked several times. And one of them was a bootleg 62, and it had they completely like dismantled, and they put like eyes that lit up in there and lit up in the mouth and everything. It was slightly smaller. I think I still have it in a box somewhere that I should have tried to find it. But anyway, finally the guy, we ended up kind of being friends. So I go in there all the time and ask him if I could buy stuff. And he's like, no, that's my display. And finally he actually sold it to me for like really cheap. So it was a long time before I actually did end up getting a 62 Godzilla. And I'll tell you that story later. It's an interesting story too.
My bad. I thought you had the original one. I apologize.
Oh, I had it. Oh, yeah. But I didn't get it back in the day. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. No. I just wanted.
It wasn't the next one. I see what we're doing here. Yeah, I do have it.
Kind of going through the originals in depth a little bit, and then we can.
But I got this much later on. Like, I didn't buy this during the time that I was buying the other one. So, sorry about that. Yeah, I do have him. He's great, and I do have the tag. And again, the front of it has the 62.
Correct, Godzilla.
And then the back, we've got a 64.
Someone got fired. When they saw all these tags, they were like, yeah, you're fired. What is this?
Yeah. So real quick, I might just have it in my hand. I'll tell you how I got him. So in 1997, we were still living in New York, and they had the G-Con convention somewhere in Midtown. I don't remember where it was, but
we probably met each other there.
No, you didn't. You know why? Because I was only in there for one reason, to go to Steve Agin's table and grab this Godzilla, because I had corresponded with him. And he's like, yeah, I'll bring it to the thing. Just come in and you can buy it. So
that was in the New York hotel?
I'm sorry. I think, yeah, it was. Yeah. Yes. So basically I walked in, went right to the table, saw my friend Toshiki from Zaka, who was in there, and I bought this from Steve, and then I left because I think I had something to do. Like, I don't know. But what a dumbass, because Nakajima was there, and you know all of the early fans. I mean, I think Rich Iso was in there, and you guys would have been like kids to me, because I was like,
oh yeah,
you know, I was you know, a young man at the time.
And in 97, I was 11.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was about to move to San Francisco. So yeah, I was a little bit older than that, but so I got him at that convention. I was in there for like 15 minutes, and stupid asked me, I didn't even have a camera, nothing.
That's almost as sad as that's when I first met Nakajima, and I got, I always forget the Hesai actor's name, but they were both there, and I got
Satsuma.
I got a picture with both of them. They signed it. I cannot. Ever since I moved, I cannot for the life of me find that picture.
It
hurts, because like I've had that in a display case forever, and I do not know where I misplaced that.
Wow. So is it more sad that you had it and lost it, or more sad that my dumb ass didn't even bother to get it? I don't know what's more pathetic. Yeah. I think mine is definitely more pathetic, because I could kick myself, because I would have loved to have seen, you know, Nakajima wasn't that old back then, and he was very spry and apparently just really, really vibrant. And I would have got to have met a lot of the people.
I was like in heaven.
Yeah, I can imagine. I don't know what I was thinking or not thinking.
I think that was when they actually showed there was a panel where they actually had the concept art for Geno, Godzilla 98.
Oh, and everyone was looking at
it,
and
everyone's like, there's no way that's actually it. And sure enough, that was it.
Well, let's keep this this show positive, because I hate that shit so much, man. I'm sorry, anybody in the chat room who likes it. I don't even think it's a good movie for like a giant monster movie. I think it sucks. It totally sucks.
Like I kind of see it both ways. I liked it as a kid because, again, I was only 12 then, and it was cool for me because all my friends knew I was a Godzilla fanatic. I was like the only, like, if anyone saw anything Godzilla, they'd like run and find me and be like, hey, look. So when that movie came out, I was like, everyone was just like, oh my God, oh my God. And so it was just cool finally having like friends actually want to talk about Godzilla. So, you know, I saw it in the theater with a bunch of my friends, and I saw the movie a couple times in the theater. We got like there was like a little cell piece to it. I don't know. It was cool. But anyway, like, I'm with you. Like, I can totally crap all over the movie and say it's garbage. And then I could also be like, eh, it's a fun monster movie. I don't personally consider it a Godzilla movie.
No. Like,
I like Zilla and Final Wars way more than I like Geno. But I do love the animated series, because that's Godzilla.
Yeah, the animated series, you know, has like, some things going for it. The monsters are cool.
Those people liked, like, you could tell those people actually had a love for the series. Whereas the directors for the actual movie were like, Godzilla sucks. We'll make him better. It's like,
I mean, it's like, you know, Matthew Broderick is a really great actor, and the dude looked like he got his script the day before. Like, he phoned that in so much. Like, he did not want to be there. He wanted that over with, and so did I. But, so anyway,
I won't lie though. Ultimate Godzilla Trendmaster, was seeing that in Toys R Us, man, that was awesome. But all right, back to why we're here. No one wants to hear about Trendmasters. We'll save that for another show. So can you hold up your original?
Yes, sir.
Show a big difference here. So here is the Forever, which in my opinion is the best set. So if you hold them to the side, you can see the big difference, obviously, is whatever scope they did on the spines. Those are gigantic. These are not. So the Forever is like a much more like grayish black. Is that even a color? With very subtle gray highlights. And then there's the Memorial. I keep doing this. Then there's the Memorial set, which, I mean, like, you can even see on the camera, it's very, very hard to tell the difference.
Yeah, it kind of is. And that one has small dorsal plates also.
Yeah, they
right?
both. Yeah. This one has more like on, like more, he's more of just a flat, whereas the Forever has the highlights, which you can kind of see on like the knees. And then the Memorial. And then, you know, obviously the tags are different. They actually got it right this time. G62 is on here. Cool. And then one of the coolest things about the Memorial set that I always liked is every figure came with the poster card.
Yeah, that's pretty. That's a cool little feature. Yep.
And for those that don't know about the Memorial box set, this big box behind me, this is the original Memorial box set. Quick pitch for the Kaiju Live show. We do have this available, complete with cards and box. If anyone's interested, just let us know.
Nice, nice.
But that is my personal one. It's 14 figures. I got a couple other ones here, but we'll keep going down the line. So that's the difference between those three. Again, because some of the figures definitely got reissued more than others.
And the thing is, I actually had some of these reissues, and I actually have sold them since, and I just kept stuck with the originals because space is definitely a commodity. And, you know, Bandai sort of took a backseat when, you know, later on in my collecting journey, when like I really got into model kits and X Plus started coming out, blah, blah, blah. But I can never, ever, ever get rid of my original Bandai figures, and they still have a place on the shelf. Like, I'm not going to put them in a box. I mean, I have some of the stuff in a box, but the original Godzilla collection figures are still displayed in my collection. So,
yeah, I have the Tolf cases from IKEA.
Nice.
Those are like perfect for like 6-inch and 8-inch figures.
Yes, indeed.
Not so much X Plus.
No.
So I believe you also have a Ghidra original, right?
I do. And this is actually not the original. This is actually...
Or the alternate tag?
This is the 88 re-release, which this tag.
I love that tag though.
Yeah, this is a great tag.
So cool.
And this you can always tell the figure if you don't have the tag by looking inside of the mouths. The mouths are painted on the reissues and they are not painted on the original.
Yep. I have the original right here because that's exactly what I wanted to go into.
And there was like, I don't even know how many of these they were made, AJ, and how many variants. I think there's like four or five actually.
There's and four.
Four.
If you count them, I'm sorry. I don't mean to cut you off.
That's okay.
I think there's five with the memorial box.
Yeah, and each color of gold that they use is slightly different. Like this one almost has some green, like a greenish gold, which if that makes any sense, shows up on the picture.
So the first two both kind of – actually, my dad's in the chat. He can explain it best because Ghidra's his favorite. So the biggest tell if it's an original is if the top of the mounts are painted. You can see red on the top. And then – the other subtlety is then some of them become more yellow. Like this, these two both have a greenish yellow tint to them. But the telltale is the top of the mouth if you're ever trying to really figure it out. And I think this one has better highlights on the inside of the wings too, right? Yeah.
This one has hardly any. There's just very subtle black on the inside of these.
Yeah, this one has definitely darker highlights, like on the back of the wings and stuff. And then here's the OG plastic tag. This is the
OG. Yes, yep.
They got this one right. They couldn't mess this one up and put a Godzilla on it. They tried to squeeze Gigan though.
This one just has the name on the back. The 88 release.
And then for the longest time, a lot of people considered the one that you have to be the rarest. But there's another wave of people that consider this one to be the rarest, and this is the damn tag version. And this one is more of a yellow gold, as you can tell, like because of my green screen, the other one was kind of fading out a little bit because it has a hint of green. This one does not. So this paint scheme is very similar, and a lot of people consider this one to be the rarest. But, you know, it really depends on who you talk to. The damn tag, again, is very hard to come across. And so that's 1, 2, 3. Cool. And then the memorial box one is just a flat yellow, but it actually has glitter in it. And you cannot tell from any picture. You literally have to, like, take it and smash it in your face and be like, oh, my God, there is glitter in there. It's the most subtle glitter paint app. Super or whatever subtle. They did, yeah. Yep. I've ever seen.
But that Ghidra figure, remember back to the beginning of my story when I saw it behind the counter for $25. Flash forward to the next year later, I'm searching all over New York City trying to find one. And of course, I can't find any. And right about then is actually, it was a couple years later, the 91 came out, the 91, which we'll get to, I'm sure. But I wanted the Showa because the Showa, like your dad, aside from Godzilla, King Ghidra, the Showa King Ghidra is my favorite monster. Like, I really love King Ghidra. And I finally saw one in a bar in the East Village right on Tompkins Square Park called Life Cafe. It was a vegetarian cafe, one of the first in the city, actually. But they had a bar at night. And I went in there with some friends and the top of the bar had all the shit nailed to it, like different kind of things, like tchotchkes and stuff. Mm-hmm. And nailed to the top of the bar by one of the wings was the Showa King Ghidra. And it looked like it was pretty good condition, except for the nail hole in the wing. And of course, I was drunk. I was trying to have someone distract the bartender. And I was trying to grab it down. It was totally unsuccessful, and I chickened out at the last minute. But that was the only one I could find for years and years and years and years, and finally I ended up getting one. I think not until I moved to California. I think I got it at either Super 7 or something like that, or somewhere in Japantown. And and that was the only casualty when I moved from San Francisco to Seattle. Was one of the necks broke, like completely snapped.
Oh, that sucks.
And thanks, but the insurance paid for it, so I upgraded to the one with the tag on it. So.
Yeah, another issue that happens with these a lot too is the horns on the head kind of snap off a lot.
They do. They can. Yep, because that vinyl gets brittle over the years.
So, quick little thing. So I brought a. Oh, he can't even see it. Hold on. The movie magic's about to disappear. Everybody, hold on a second. where are you? All right, there we go. So these just came in.
That's awesome.
You can find the I cannot actually believe how good these are. Because we just opened up a Teespring store with a bunch of Kaiju Live merch. So I got a bunch of samples, obviously, because I've never ordered from there before. So I personally wanted to know what kind of quality we were getting. This is incredible. These stretchy elastic bands, it's actually super comfortable. And our modified logo, I kind of can't make it out because of the creases, is sublimated into it, which means it's literally never going to fade. These came out incredible.
That's awesome.
So if you want, definitely check out the Teespring Kaiju Live store. You can get those there. So quick plug. Excellent. Sorry. Didn't mean to.
Plug away, man. Do it. Do it.
All right, Movie Magic's back. There we go.
I like it.
All right. So before we move on to more of the, there's still one more original we haven't covered, and I don't think you had him.
Which one is that? I've got him. He's down there. He's not here. If you want to hold on a second, I'll grab him.
Okay.
Hold on.
Yes, there's other stuff. There's stuff behind David. Don't worry. The bronze will be coming up for a closer up look. We're gonna get one of the cover Mecha Godzilla,
and then we'll get into my collection room is tore up, man. It's tore up. I kind of like dive over stuff. So here we go. He doesn't have his tag on him. His tag is safely packed away in a box.
So again, they messed up. Here we have G64, but he's actually on the back. So, do you know the telltale of the difference between the original and a reissue?
Is it size? Is it slightly bigger?
One is slightly bigger, but there is also another telltale.
Tell us, AJ.
Yes. So, as you can tell here, you can see I think the molds got destroyed. So they had they couldn't use the original one. So the reissue is slightly smaller. But if you don't have two people showing you, like, hey, look, this one is really the reissue. Because, that stuff happens sometimes. They call it the button test. So the original button on the bottom of his tail is indented. Whereas on all of the reissues, it bubbles out. It actually is not indented in.
Oh, damned. Okay.
So that is the telltale if you're ever trying to figure it out. And again, this is another people consider to possibly be more rarer than the original, which I don't know. I'm a plastic tag guy, so it doesn't matter to me. I always prefer the original plastic tags. Those were always my grails when we were chasing. But again, the damn tags on some of the original ones like the Ghidra and now Mecha are...
Oh, there's a lot of black on this. Look how dark it is.
Yeah, and the there's a much darker paint scheme.
Yeah, there's like hardly any on this one.
But again, and then some of them come, a lot of these were hand painted, I'm pretty sure.
That's true.
So
that's true.
It really depended on who was painting your stuff. And then I believe the Memorial Box one, which I did not bring up, he's really just silver. Like, he doesn't really have a lot of highlights to him, but he's the same size as the reissue. So that's always the telltale on those ones. So a little
nice,
little shocking knowledge.
Can you let the chat room around? No, I can let the chat room know. I can't really see the comments. So if anybody has any questions they want to ask, sorry, I'm not ignoring you. I just can't see them. So.
Yeah, I tried to put it up on the screen so you didn't have monitor two things. And I was trying something out and it actually worked. So that's nice.
That's fine. I'm just not ignoring anybody if someone is asking a question or wants to say something. So that's when I put that out there.
How is the audio level? I actually meant to ask this when we first started streaming. How is the audio levels between me and David? Because I know on some of the other streams, I'm either lower or vice versa. So I just want to make sure we're kind of sounding like we're almost in the same room, maybe, kind of. If not, let me know who needs to go up, who needs to go down. All right, so that's it for the OGs, as I like to call them. But now there's a different set of OGs. Do you have any of the GMSs?
Yes, I do. I do. I have this guy right here. I've got the original release, the 84 release of the 64 Godzilla.
Oh man, Dad, you still in the chat? I forget what the difference is between the. I know the reissue is, I think, slightly smaller, but there's also a paint difference, and I cannot remember what it is.
This one, you can't really base it on this one because I actually touched this one up.
I was going to say, yours looks super clean.
Yeah, I touched him up. I was able to match the exact color of the paint, and I did this a long time ago. He's touched up a little bit. Probably even so much that it doesn't look accurate, but it's pretty. It had a few scratches in it when I purchased him. So yeah, that's the one, man. That is the copper.
I touched this one up a little bit. No, I'm just kidding. Actually, speaking of touch ups, this is one of the most bootleg Bandais of all time. And if you're out on the hunt trying to find a real one. Another great tell is the bottom of his feet. If someone is trying to sell you one and they will not show you the bottom of the feet, it's fake. Because the bottom of the feet, this was made on a brown vinyl. Yep. So when a lot of people just, whenever they were bootlegging, I guess, never really wanted to go the full mile to to cover up his feet. So that was always the telltale, whether you were getting a real bronze or not. This is my dad and I, like, this and the Forever set to me is the grail of grails when it comes to Bandai.
It's one of mine too. I've never had it and I've always wanted it. And someday that one will be mine. Let me ask you this. Is he tacky?
No.
He's not tacky at all. I've actually held some that have were...
That slime on them, yeah.
That were actually original releases and legit, not bootlegs, and there was the paint was still super tacky on it. So, I don't know what process caused that to happen, but
is that part of a smokehouse thing? Is that has something to do with it a little bit? Maybe
it might, but I think that the one that I saw, the person had like a really pristine collection with no, I think it was a smoke-free home, but I don't know. That's something maybe
sometimes, cause I've actually, when I was, living at my dad's, back in the day, I was in the basement and our basement was extremely humid. So sometimes that plays into it. My X Plus Fedora literally crouched over into a position that when I started, when I got back into X Plus and everything and like joined all the groups and seeing people's fedoras, I'm like, mine doesn't look like that. What's mine's deal? And then I was like, oh, he literally just humped over into a different figure. And I had to like him up. I had to heat him up till he was literally almost like putty. So he reformed back. Nice. Because he's got like the arm up 30 centimeter.
Yeah.
Like mine was like, he was just like, nah, I'm not even doing that anymore.
Whoa.
Sometimes the humidity could play into that.
I'm jealous of that piece. I have a lot of cool stuff in my collection that I'm really proud of, but I was never able to score that one at a reasonable price and make sure it was legit, And you got one that's not tacky either, so that's you definitely win on that one. That's so
speaking
cool.
Speaking of price, one thing that's always kind of baffled me with Bandai is like I get, in the late 90s, early 2000s, they were in, supply and demand, all that stuff. And, I'm sure we all spent a lot of money on some Bandais that now we're like, well, they're not even worth near that. And it's always kind of fascinated me because, Like, obviously, like, if you look at the vintage stuff, like, you know, bull marks, like, you'll have, like, a, you know, original Megalon. That's, you know, obviously now been reissued, I don't even know, thousands of times at this point between M1 and whatever. But the original still holds its value. The original, you know, can go for a couple $1,000s. It's really strange to me that, like, X Plus came along and Bandai just, like, their prices did not hold. And like as a collector, as a collector, that kind of hurts, because you know, it's like, oh cool, I have to, you know, if I ever wanted to sell my Bandai collection, which I don't, by the way, no, don't want to ask, this is not for sale, like, it's just like, oh, I'm gonna have to, you know, basically sell it for a quarter of what, you know, I originally, me and my dad originally put into it.
So yeah, I think that's true. I always kind of
found that weird that it really only happened to Bandai.
I think that's true for many of the pieces, AJ. But like, for example, your gold Great Monster series, that one never really there's certain pieces that really did hold their value, and I still will never ever sell my originals that we just went over, because those are all associated with great memories of when I started this toy collecting journey in New York, and those days when there was no internet, man, you had to go get off your ass, go to these stores, look all over the city. And I found like many places to buy. We had Forbidden Planet, Children of Paradise, Zaka, Village Comics. This is even before Toy Tokyo. Toy Tokyo is more of a recent thing. But you know, even little like vintage clothing stores like Love Saves the Day. Remember that place that was around the corner from my house.
Remember
that
had Bandai Planet, in there. And that like had Outer Limits was
Well, Outer Limits, that was Jim Cirinella's store, wasn't it? In Clifton, New Jersey, wasn't it?
I believe it was, actually, yeah.
I think that was Jim's store. Yeah, shout out to Jim.
I actually have funny you should mention that. Since we're talking about selling originals, sneak peek for you, there's going to be some original plastic tag Bandais on the next show. And one of them actually has the original price tag from Outer Limits on it.
Okay, that's cool. That's pretty cool.
But as I like we're, you know, so like I find like those cool, like when stuff has the original price tag and you're like, damn, I could have got this for X, or then you were like, oh man, I can't get this at all now. That's always kind of fun when it comes to that stuff.
I think Bandai is going to eventually sort of come back into favor with collectors, because it is like one of the coolest lines of any Godzilla toy line, and you know, it's what many of us started our collections with. Oh yeah, there he is. Another one that eluded me that I never actually purchased. So
So this one isn't mine. This is actually one that we had just sold recently on the show, but he was right next to me, so I figured why not just leave him and grab him. So this is the before we had Big Bad X Plus figures. This is the biggest Ghidra you could ever find. This is the GMS Ghidra, and they call him, nickname is the Fragile Wing. And the reason why, obviously, is because these tabs... Again, someone got fired. I don't understand. These tabs are so thin that trying to actually get the wings in, 90% of the time, you're going to break them. He is called, like, if you get this figure, if you, you know, if this is something you're chasing, by the way, we do have another one available with box PMS.
Oh, don't tempt me. Oh, my God. Wow. You might just inspire me to want one after our chat, see?
So, but this sculpt is awesome. I mean, I love Showa Ghidra. Totally, it's awesome. a little weird that they kind of, like, it looks like you can just cut his head off and his brain would be there. Bop his head off with the seam there, but I love this. Was always one of our favorites, and I've still never taken ours out of the box. Like, ours is just in there, and I've been thinking of doing something cool, like because the wings are so fragile and I don't even want to mess with that, like getting a poster frame that can fit them both and put like you know, a Monster Zero poster in there with the wings. And like, put it like right behind him, so it still kind of gives you like that flying effect.
That's a cool
idea.
That's
something that I've been kicking around that I don't have the room for, but that's an idea that I do have.
Wow. Yeah. Do you want to hear a little story about him? I've got a little story about him too, about the fragile wing King Ghidra. I'll say it quick. Back when I was spying the 1964 Bandai Godzilla at Forbidden Planet, used to go downstairs and they had a whole section of toys down there. And they had this big like table where they would have samples of the different toys that you could actually pick up and look at, right? So hanging above that, they had airplanes and pterodactyls and things that fly, you know, and right in the center of it all was a fragile wing King Ghidra hung up with fishing line. Okay. And I would go in there and I would be like, man, that is the coolest thing I've ever seen. And I kept asking the salespeople, is that for sale? Can I buy that? In reality, I did not have the money to buy it. And I never intended to buy it. Oh, there's the instructions too. That's freaking awesome.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Stick wing in tab and hope it doesn't break. Those are the instructions. I think I deciphered it.
That is crazy. That is crazy. But so yeah, no. It's hanging up there. And I keep going in and asking with really, I probably would have been really upset if they said you can buy it because I didn't have the money to buy it because I knew it was going to be way out of my price range. So I ended up going there one day and it was gone. And I said, hey, what happened to that Ghidra that was up there? Oh. And the guy's like, the owner sold it. I'm like, what?
Wow.
So it was there for like a year and I go in there and look at it and hang out with it, but I never was able to get it.
So here's a ruler, okay? It is, the ruler is thicker than this insert. Like, wow. If you can see. Like,
that's crazy.
It's, again, if this is something you're on the hunt for, I strongly recommend, like, if you're, you know, you're trying to complete your collection, you know, you're chasing them all, do not. Just don't try it. You're just going to get frustrated and.
Okay, you just talked me out of it.
No. Hey, the poster idea is cool because that's what I want.
I have no room anyway. My. I am like completely at capacity. I've got three X Plus Ghidras like taking up a lot of space up here.
You got three?
And yeah, I've got the 68, right? Mm-hmm. And I've got two versions of the 64. I've got the gold, Rick and the... And I had to get the special blue one. And I never would have gotten the gold one unless I saw it at the Kinokuniya Godzilla pop-up store. In 2018, summer of 2018, and I saw it in person, and I was like, this thing is really awesome. And I got it for a really good price. So yes, I do have three. You know, hey man, lay off. I've got like thousands of Godzillas and I only have three Ghidras, so give me a break, man.
Yeah, I thought about double dipping on that one in particular. I'm not a big double dipper.
Me neither. I mean, no.
But I have the flying 68. So I was like, I'm good. I like them, the dynamic of having both. But that, in my opinion, that was my personal figure of last year was the Rick King Ghidra.
The flying one.
No. The blue. Yeah, the promo one.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Like Andy Peters says, it sticks out amongst the sea of gray.
It does. and it's a piece of, you know, Toho history that we're seeing, you know, right before us, because that was, you know, Toho's one of their original concepts for that monster is to have the blue color with the rainbow wing. So that's pretty awesome. King Kong.
Since
these are all the same, I'm going to just let mine are all down there and like, there's no variants really of these, like the original. So I'm just going to let you,
let me run through a few, and if you have any questions, so this is another one of the Bandais that still has held its value, especially with tag, mainly because there's no real, like, there's no Kong products other than, like, you know, I know Roto Kaiju has that one that's great with the X pluses and stuff like that, but in terms of old one? Oh okay
you mean this one,
dude.
Yeah, this is great. But having a representation of the goofy Toho 62 Kong, what back in the day, this is like way back in the day, was like the coolest thing ever.
Yeah, I'm still, I don't know what the deal is with that. I don't, I know, It has to obviously be a rights issue. But I'm still shocked that X Plus hasn't released, especially with the new movie coming out, like even, you know, just something. But, and then, so you got the Kong, which is still, you know, great again, because he's not really represented. And another character that's not really represented a lot either. Mechanicon.
Yes, sir.
And that's this cool, is another one that still, you know, can still come in that, you know, crack 100 kind of range. Especially with Tag and the condition he's in. You could see, you know, again, these are figures from the 80s. Actually, no, this is 91. I apologize.
Yep.
You can see, like, you know, scuffs around the traditional wear and tear. You're never going to... That was actually one of my favorite things, again, because, like, I never was really into the Marmot stuff when that was coming out originally.
You mean the Vinyl Paradise line?
Yeah, Vinyl Paradise. Like, it's so funny now, because now I've completely 180'd and, like, I love that stuff now. I don't know. But when I was a kid, like, my dad liked that stuff, and I was like, it was, like, kind of cheesy. And then, so, like, it's weird how all that stuff kind of comes, like, full circle. Because now it's like, hey, does that thing glow? Because I like it now. Does it got some glitter on it? I dig it now.
It's your collecting journey. We all take, like, different paths, and we end up kind of in the same space having a little bit of everything, but everybody evolves. Like, there was a time where I only wanted the realistic stuff. There's the Gorosaurus. Yep.
Another awesome character that is very underrepresented. Love Goro. I wish he was in the MonsterVerse. It's so easy. It's just a T-Rex. Just put him in. Kangaroo Kick. Just going through a couple here. Here's another one that, again, people still love. This is another one that holds its Kamakuris. Don't really see a lot anymore. No. I would probably consider him to be one of the rarer Bandais now, along with the one like Kong. Kong and Mechanicon you don't see too often anymore either. But love Kamakuris. I actually finally just got an X Plus Kamakuris. I've been getting rid of pretty much all of my 25 centimeters, but I know the Kamakuris is, like, gigantic.
Pretty big, yeah.
So it's like he's like Kumunga. Like, he's a 30 centimeter.
Yeah, he's pretty big.
So what do you have?
All right, I'm gonna show you one of my favorites from the original Godzilla collection. This one is very hard to find, and it kind of retained its value also because of a certain feature that gets broken off quite frequently. Mogera.
Ah, yes.
This one is really well done for a Bandai figure, and it really, you know, looks like the monster, like really a lot looks like the monster. And these antennas are pretty fragile. And it's very hard to find one with the antennas intact.
Yeah.
So he's another one that I do you have him?
Yes, he's stowed away in the case.
Yeah, he's a standout for me. And you know, some of the other ones are really well done, but as far as, like, being a one that relatively retains its value.
Yeah, if you can find one with the antennas still intact, like, it's, you know, because I almost feel like 90% of those do not have the antennas ever.
Oh, for sure.
I actually remember, funny story. There's a comic book place by me out here on Long Island, Fourth World Comics, and I remember they had a barrel of those, just him. Like,
just Mogera?
Yes, just that one. They had, like, a legit. I mean, I guess I was a kid. Maybe it was bigger than what it was. But it was a large size bucket, let's go with, where there was just so many of them. And I think that's actually where we got him. And then a couple of years later, we had gone back. Because we always kind of stopped in Fourth World every couple months. And they stopped having Godzilla toys. And I, like, got mad. And I was still, like, a little kid. I was just like, why don't you have them anymore? And the guy was like, what? It's like, where are my toys? How do you not have them?
Bring them back.
Yeah. How dare you, sir?
So here's another from the original that I was very stoked to have. The 56 Rodan is really, really, really well done too. Again, like all Rodans, almost every single Rodan on the planet, it has a leaning problem, and he topples over pretty easily. So it's I have to put some earthquake putty on the bottom. So, but they went as far as to like really duplicate the green stripe on the back, which actually is in the film. So I was really, really excited to get a Rodan figure, because my favorites, you know, Godzilla number one, King Ghidorah's number two, and Rodan is a very close number three. I call it the big three. Those are my always will be my favorites. And
could there you used imagine to be if the FSO that coming out has a some kind of leaning problem? I think it would be the most hilarious thing, but I think that's why they gave him a base.
That's why they gave him a base. Yeah,
now they're like, no more. We can't have
does
this
the
again.
Rick. Do you have to buy the Rick to get the base, or they both have a base?
I don't even know. Yeah, they haven't. I don't think officially announced whether it's. It might just be a Rick only kind of deal, possibly.
Well, I'm getting the Rick only because, you know, all of the stuff coming out. No, there's some stuff. It's pretty cool. I like it. But the only one I'm really stoked about that I'm definitely going to pull the trigger on is the 56 Rodan from the I think it's the Kaiju Freaks mold model kit. And the original model kit he's actually perched on top of the Tokyo department store, which is really cool. It's a huge piece.
Oh wow.
So it's a 30 centimeter figure. And then the base
30 centimeter building.
I mean, it's a massive amazing piece of resin. So pretty cool stuff. So I think the rest of them, I mean, they did Angulus, Minya, Baragon, you know, pretty much all of the monsters that you'd want to see. But there was actually a rumor back in the day when I started to, there was a few friends I had that collected these things. And there was a rumor that Bandai is going to put out a Gabra and a Titanosaurus in the original series, not the later on 6-inch, but in the first series. And it never happened. It was a complete like myth or fabrication or fake news, as they say now. But I always wanted a Gabra and a Titanosaurus in this line. You know, that's what's missing. And also a Kumonga, Gabra, Titanosaurus were the three that were really missing from that first series.
Yeah. Well, then we at least got Titano in the 6-inch.
Eventually, yeah. And really well done, but the smaller scale. And I mean, we could talk about that at a different time.
Yeah,
but,
that's show two.
Yeah, I would really have loved to have seen those two be represented. I mean, I don't know how people feel about Gabra. I love Gabra. I think he's a cool monster. I love his design.
I love that movie. I mean, I know everyone ranks on that movie because it's a little kid movie. It's the perfect little kid movie.
It's the perfect little kid movie. I saw it when I was a little kid, so I liked it.
Exactly. My dad made me show this figure. Again, we wanted to keep this Godzilla only, but dad insisted that we pull this out.
Let's see.
This is the first ever Bandai Theater issue from a movie called Peking Man. Peking Man, obviously it's a mammoth with cave people on it.
That's so cool. I've never seen that before.
This one's still pretty rare. You don't really see this. This is the first ever Bandai theater issue they ever did for a movie. And then obviously we know the train that started, where theater issues became the hot commodity.
Yes, indeed.
And, you know, that was like the be all end all at one point was like, what's the theater issue? What's going to be the theater issue for this movie? What is it?
That's right.
So I had to show that dad would not let me do this show without showing that.
That's a super cool piece. That is a really very
there you
cool
go. He's
a, rare piece.
Peking Man.
Peking Man.
I don't know. I pronounce everything terribly. So before we move on to, I even skipped it. I'm not gonna take this out. It's still literally like cellophane wrap.
This is the GMS
Mothra. It's the exact same sculpt as the regular 89 Mothra that they released the larva, but it's a full-on squish toy. Like you can just squeeze it. It's just a rubber version of it. It's pretty cool. And this one, it's never left this box.
And the box is great. The box itself is great.
Yeah, the box is awesome. I'm giving everyone a...
Very cool.
Ravishing a universe for love.
That's right.
Mightiest monster in all creation.
Yes, indeed. A big giant caterpillar. Yes, the mightiest monster. Yes, indeed. I love that stuff. That stuff brings me back. That's like...
Yeah.
Yeah, good stuff.
So do you have anything else that you wanted to show that I could bounce off?
No, I think that we pretty much covered a lot of the standouts from that series because you can't show everything. So
no.
We can move on to the next.
So I'm going to get into my personal favorite Bandai set, so to speak, the Forever set. So these were basically... You know, at one point in time, this was the set. Like, you needed the Forever set. And the paint apps on these are incredible. Like, you can see Mecha King Ghidorah has a beautiful chrome paint app, whereas the original one is a... It's not chrome. It's just gray. So there's a big difference. And the original one, I don't even think has the yellow panels, does it?
I don't believe it does. No, I think it's solid gray wings, if I'm not mistaken. I don't have him. But
I see it. I can't get it. But yeah, so like this, the wings and the body on the original are just gray. So this was probably one of the most sought after Forever pieces just because of the incredible paint app and difference that they did. So all the Forever pieces kind of had running out of space here. All the Forever pieces kind of had little differences to them. I already showed you the 62, which it's very subtle. I know it's Disco Fever time. All the X Plus fans out there, including myself.
I never got that one. That's the only one in the set that I don't have.
This is the original. One of my personal favorites, mainly because this movie is my favorite Hesai movie. I love the glitter on this. I kind of wish the X Plus was a little bit more like this sparkly. Like, you can see, like, this thing when light hits it, it's a party.
Yeah, X Plus should have been go big or go home on that one, I think, you know.
Yeah. Then you have Baby Godzilla, which, again, you know, probably, you know, not the most popular Forever piece, but again, this one's really cool because it has much better highlights. Like, it actually did the toes and the nails, whereas the original one is just flat blue. That's they didn't even bother throwing some paint on it. They're like, it's fine. And I think the blue is slightly different, a little brighter.
I think the blue is the tone is a little different. Yeah,
and one of the coolest, like, kind of cool but cheesy that I really just dig is the Forever Fire Rodan, because they gave him like these cool veins on his wings, the regular one does not have. So this, they tried to give him like the veins that you can see in the movie.
Right.
So, and yet another Rodan that, you know, we always like hung these up by fish wire and stuff like that, because again, he needs a friend to stand, as do all Rodans.
Yes, they do. The Rodan really curse, cool. Which will hopefully be broken in this next one.
I hope so. And then last but not least, which was a play off of the... so this was like the Burning Godzilla. Oh, there we go. Whoa, we both got this one. Here we go. All right, you take it away. Go ahead.
So this is a really special figure for me. This came out in, was this 91 or 92? I guess this was 92 or 91. I don't have the tag. His tag's not on him, but I have it packed away.
This is 96.
Sorry. 96. So basically, I used to hang out at a store called Zaka on Bruin Street, Japanese shop, and they had a lot of Godzilla toys in there, including Bandai. And that's where I would get a lot of the things. And I do a lot of wish shopping, and I was friends with the owner. And my birthday was coming around, and my husband Keith, back then, you know, we were together only a couple of years, and he went in there and asked Toshiki, the owner, what I'd been eyeing up in the store so you could buy it for my birthday. And this was the one that you know, I was eyeing up. Sure enough, ended up being a birthday gift. So pretty cool figure. I'm not a huge Heisei collector. Like, I have only the pieces that speak to me. I pretty much have all the Godzillas, but as far as the other figures, I don't have every one. I don't have the Mecha King Ghidorah or that kind of thing. But I do have the three of these, the standard, the theater exclusive, which we'll mm-hmm. I'm sure we'll talk about, and then this guy. So he's a special figure to me. Love him. One of the ones that will never go anywhere.
Really cool.
My collection. It's really well done too. It actually kind of looks like a marmot.
Is he painted on the inside? Is that how they did this one?
Yeah, he's got paint on the inside and the outside. Like it's really, really an interesting, a very intricate figure. And over time, the vinyl sort of got a little bit yellowed bit. I can't even remember if that's the way it was in the beginning, but I kind of like the way it looks now. It kind of looks cool. So
yeah,
I'm not mad at it. So he's a real special figure because he was a gift. So
that's awesome.
And figures, you know, I have such a big collection that figures that are gifts or I pick up at a special place that are associated with a specific memory, those are the ones that mean the most to me in my collection. So
absolutely. That's
he's in the ranks of those.
So I have a funny story with like the Forever and like the OGs that we actually didn't end up getting. This was like when we were, you know, just getting into the hobby. Someone had this back in the eBay days. You know, there was a posting and it had the Forever set, basically like all the originals with plastic tag.
Wow.
You know,
that's like
a
lot?
Yeah, it was a whole lot, right? And I forget where me and my dad, I'm like, you know, again, I'm super young. I'm watching my dad trying to snipe on eBay. And it ended up going for like $1,500 for the whole lot. And we were in there for a while. And then I remember dad turning to me and being like, you know what? I'm glad we lost because I wouldn't have been able to pay any of the bills this month.
Oh, so yeah, things happen for a reason, I guess. Yeah. Like, wow.
You know, we obviously ended up getting them down the line, but that was always a funny story that stuck with me.
We've all been there. We're in the tense moments
of like watching the bin and then someone snipes you, you like throw the table, you're like, God damn it. Especially back then, they had, you know, eBay sniping was is eBay sniping still a thing? I don't even know.
I haven't bought anything from eBay AJ in like I can't even tell you how long because it's a really long time. I know enough people and I'm in enough groups now where I kind of know what people are looking for. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of put it like, hey, anybody need this? Or hey, I heard you need this.
I've always liked how like Yahoo Japan does theirs where like if someone bids, there's another 5 minutes slapped on. Fight away. I've always liked
that inspired your, you know, let them fight on your show. So
actually pretty much someone had said that in the chat and I just quickly grabbed the clip. It was the same thing with a happy moment. Someone said a happy moment and I was like, that's it. That's the tagline.
Every time the happy moment plays, it just makes me smile. It's just really funny. I love that. And because I was watching your show one night and I didn't have the headphones on. I was watching Keith's listening. He's like, what the hell is that sound? What does that mean? And then I had to explain it to him. He's like, oh, from that. Okay, got it. So it's pretty funny.
So we skipped ahead. Sorry about that. We kind of just jumbled all over.
Hey, it's our show. We can do what we want.
Exactly. There's one figure that was the very first of its kind, so to speak, and it was a closed mouth Godzilla that used to be highly, highly sought after and considered the that used to be a Buko Buck one, as we used to say out there.
One of my
Dad says Showcase Collectibles won that auction. Back in the day. What a story.
Sean Linkenback. Right?
The living That's Sean. Legend. Yes. The man.
So this guy is one of my all time favorite Bandai figures of all time.
I call him the piano player, but I love it anyway.
It's just so well done. And I remember getting this figure actually before I saw a good copy of Biollante. Okay. So I was like, I saw the design of the Heisei Godzilla. This is basically the 89-91. They're very similar. Mm-hmm. Slight differences, of course, to the discerning, you know, Godzilla collector. But anyway, I was just so stoked to see this. I was like, this is the coolest Godzilla I've ever seen. Like, the proportions are great. Excuse me. I love everything about it.
And it had a closed mouth, which
and it's and, a, never and it's did. Closed mouth. And wait, where are we going? Yeah, and yeah. I absolutely love. Oh, it still has the. Okay, this is cool. Now I just realized this. It's got the price tag on it, and it's where I bought it from. So guess how much I paid for this guy.
What year was it?
This was 1991. Take a guess.
$25.
Lower.
No. $12. What do we got?
Wait, the fucking thing.
Other the way. There we go.
1999.
I said it says 1990. What a weird price.
Oh, sorry. 1990. Right.
The guy.
And I got this at a toy shop in Chinatown in New York City called Waku Trading that had for a very short time had a lot of cool Godzilla stuff in there. I actually bought a Max Factory 1992 Godzilla model kit with Batra and Mothra in that same shop for super cheap. So 1990 in 1991 for the closed mouth Godzilla. So I love that tag's still on there. I didn't even realize that.
That's awesome. Wow. And then they did another
58 Mott Street, just in case. I doubt if it's still there. But
yeah, I don't think a lot of the old places aren't just not there.
I'm sure
anymore.
Some of the old timers, you know, New York collectors will remember Waku Trading. And
Then the rarer version of that is this, the Evolution set.
Right.
Which
nice.
Came in a blister pack. I'm pretty sure they basically have the same paint app. I don't never really noticed. I don't think they really did anything special. It's really hard to find. Like, you can even see, like, our blister, you know, it's cracked over here and everything. It's very hard to find one that has stood the test of time. But I'm happy they just stay in place. So I love this one.
Yeah, it's a great box. Great dynamic blister pack too.
Always loved Godzillasaurus. He doesn't get enough love.
No, I want X Plus to do not a Godzillasaurus just as like a Rick extra. I want to see a straight up 25 centimeter or 30 centimeter Godzillasaurus. How cool would that
be? Yeah, it'd be
why not, right?
Yeah,
it'd be different. It'd be different.
Yeah, because he's brown. Just one of my favorites. Anything that adds a little extra color. It's like just a little extra color.
Yeah, man.
So what do you got?
So next is the natural progression, and the tag just fell behind the shelf. But this is the Godzilla versus Mothra.
Yes.
And now it's similar to the 91 figure, but the mouth is open and he's a little bit chunkier. And they came out with two versions of it. One with the silver, and this one has the bluish dorsal plates. I think the one, I'm not sure which was which. I think this one was for the 92 and the other one was for the 93 because they basically use the same one for 2 years.
And I think they used it for 94 as well. The Space Godzilla one's the
same
too.
They did. I think you're right. So, I think this one got a lot of airplay and so he's a pretty it's a nice figure. I mean, still not as iconic as the closed mouth, but they did a really nice job on these. And there was place.
I love the eyes on it. Like, I just
the eyes are great. He looks straight up. Oh yeah, these eyes are like almost gold. The color of the paint is gold on these one mm-hmm. on this one. And this is about the time where I discovered that there was this cool toy store in Edgewater, New Jersey. Okay, there was a place called Johann Plaza in Edgewater, New Jersey. And I used to take the Port Authority bus from, you know, New York City, go right through like, you know, Fort Lee and just, you know, go right around and go to this Japanese mall. And they had a books, Kinokuniya, they had like a food court and they had a store called Pony Toy Go Round. And there was one in LA, I think, and one in San Francisco too, if I'm not mistaken. No, only one in LA. And it was basically a toy shop that had tons of Bandais. Mm-hmm. And they had this, I don't know what you call it. It's one of those things that you spin around and it has like the arms that come out and you can just stack figures on, like
I know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. And they had like many of them all over the store. Some of them were completely covered with Ultra Monsters. Some of them were completely covered with Godzilla figures. And they were super cheap. Like they were really like, this was probably, if I can find the tag, maybe the price tag's still on there. Hold on a second. Probably about $20, which is pretty good back then. Let me see if the tag's on there. Yes, as a matter of fact, it's on there. And it was $20.75.
Man, what are up with these weird price tags? 75 cents.
This is from Pony Toy Go Round. It says New Godzilla 1992, $20.75.
Awesome.
Great little shop. And I used to like, you know, it'd be like a whole afternoon. Like I'd go to Port, because I was living in Manhattan at the time, and take the bus down there, have a nice lunch at the Japanese, you know, food court, and then go and grab some toys and go into the bookstore and check out all the old, now they're not old, they were new at the time, Hobby Japan magazines, and have a really fun day. I go by myself because I really didn't have anybody to sort of like do this stuff with. So yeah, it was my own little private thing that I did, which is
I think everyone that collects has always been in that bubble by themselves for a while until they're like, oh my God, there are other, like, there are other people just like me. I remember, like, you know, my wife has always, you know, never really understood it, you know, which was just like, okay, yeah, cool, you do your thing, but you're weird. And then when we started, you know, when I joined my dad and started, you know, co-hosting Kaiju Live, and, you know, she helps out, she's behind the scenes, she, you know, she boxes everything and keeps everyone's stuff in order. And
that's cool. Super cool.
You know, and then she came to G-Fest with us. Well, was it last year? Yeah, last year. And, you know, and she's like, I get it now. I understand. And it's like, yes. That's all I ever wanted was just to understand.
That's really cool.
But since we brought up Space Godzilla real quick.
Oh, yeah, there he is.
So this is the Memorial Box one, which I actually like more, mainly because he's darker.
Yeah, the paint app is definitely better on the Memorial Box.
Yeah, the Memorial, like, it's a deeper red and a deeper blue, which I actually really like. The original, I mean, I still like the original too. He's more of a brighter blue.
Right.
But then probably my favorite Memorial Box, and again, I'm sorry, I know we're jumping around all over the place. It goes back to my old buddy. Oh man, he's got some webbing back here. Haven't cleaned these in a long time.
Uh-oh.
The blue Memorial Gigan.
Yep. Pretty nice.
I love the grayish blue Gigan. It's by far my favorite. So I love this on the Memorial Box. That's why the Memorial Box is really cool, because they really tried to give you a different take. Whether it was more color accurate or just kind of like doing whatever. They were like, eh. Kind of like the 62, where they were just like, he's gonna be black now. And you're like, okay, I guess, sure.
It's definitely a bold color choice, because it kind of strays from all the other ones, you know.
Yeah, I mean, well, the original one's like an olive green. Yeah. So you're like, how did you go from olive green to literally just
like a light dark, blue, like a pale blue? Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, what?
Pretty cool.
And then, going back to what we were just talking about with the 91, you also have the King Scale,
I believe? I do.
I believe lying around.
I do. And he's right here. He needs a little bit of a dusting. His tail's a little dusty. But,
yeah. But, now seeing all my figures, I'm like, oh, I haven't treated you well these last couple of years.
So this guy, I think I got him at Pony Toy Go Around 2. Maybe not, because the box was really big. I don't remember schlepping the box on the bus. But anyway, I got him somewhere in New York City. And I think he was about $100 back in the day. Like, I think that's close to 100, like around there.
Yeah.
not much more than that, but he came in a nice big box. And it's, again, it's basically the same sculpt as the smaller closed mouth, but his mouth is open. And has really great brown paint app on the eyes. Looks really, really looks and really
that's,
good.
And that's the original one, right? The hard vinyl?
Yeah, this is the hard vinyl, yep. Yeah. And I think I remember he was even being featured on one of those episodes of Comic Book
Men
or whatever. Yeah, and I think they were trying to figure out if one was a bootleg or not. I don't remember the exact episode.
I remember they had the RC Mechagodzilla on there.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, neat. They put that on there once too. I was like, oh, that's awesome.
But it's a great figure. It was one of the biggest pieces I had I had in my collection at the time. The Great Monster 64 was the biggest I had, and then he was the second biggest. And yeah, it just really fun time to be a collector and to sort of see what they're going to come up with next. And because at this point, the movies were still being popped out. Because mm-hmm. we backtracked a little bit. This is before like 95.
We're jumping
around. And this probably came out in like 92, I think.
But, I think so, yeah. And then the reissue came out. If you're ever trying to figure out if you have the original or the reissue, the original is hard, hard vinyl. You can hear the knocking. Whereas the reissue is a softer vinyl, and I think they actually had one came from a different place. I think there was a Japan version and then a Korea version. That might have been on the 91 closed mouth, actually. There is that too.
Did the reissue come with a box or no?
I don't know. Dad, are you still there? Anyone in the chat? Did the reissue come with a box? I'm gonna guess it did.
Yeah, maybe it probably did.
But yeah, he was another one that got knocked off a lot.
What's interesting about this one, AJ, is when I saw the episode of the Comic Book Men when they're trying to decipher the difference between a bootleg and the original. There's a section of the tail that's kind of soldered together, right? Okay. And I didn't realize that that's the way the original was, because this is definitely the original. And you probably can't even see it on there, but there's a part of the tail that's sort of like, there's a seam, but they kind of soldered it and then they painted over it. So it's legit. It's totally legit.
And that's why it came in a gigantic box.
I mean, I never when I first had this, I never even really noticed it, because I was just looking at the figure and wondering where I'm going to put it in my tiny apartment in the East Village. This is back when I didn't have a collection room. This stuff lived in the one room that we had. I mean, we basically had a kitchen, a bathroom, a living room, and a bedroom. That's it.
And there was
I lived on St. Mark's Place between 2nd and 3rd Avenue. It was a cool-ass neighborhood, right? And I loved living there, every minute of living there. But there's no way that if we didn't move from there, I never would have been able to buy anything, because A, I couldn't afford it, and B, there's nowhere to put it. So the next stop was Brooklyn. We moved to Park Slope, Brooklyn, for a slightly bigger place.
Oh, nice.
Actually, it was a much bigger place. And there was actually had a room to display this stuff.
When I was finally leaving the nest and house hunting, the number one thing on my list has to have a full basement. I need to have my cave. All right, that I can just put crap all over the place.
one of your non-negotiables. Yeah, no.
Yeah,
hey,
it was just there is, and you have no say. The basement is mine. You have no power here. You know.
in California homes, they don't have basements in Northern California anyway, because of the earthquake situation, right? So my stuff, we had like a partially finished garage in our house in Oakland. And we never put the car in there, because it was like, that's where my collection went. So the collection, it wasn't nearly the scale that it is now. It was probably about half of this, or less than half of the size now. But the stuff lived in the garage.
For those just tuning in, someone asked if we had shown. So just want to, there he is again.
The bronze, and here's the normal, here's the regular release.
The OGs. So speaking of... I'm gonna probably let's hope I don't drop this. So since we did the king scale, I think there's really not many other ones we haven't covered. One figures that I'm disappointed I didn't pull out. I'll get them for the part two. We'll just do a little quick thing on it because we definitely want to focus on the other stuff. Is the Mothra and Batra adults with the acrylic wings?
Yes,
I love those figures. Yep, and
I have those in boxes.
I don't anymore, and I really wish I would have kept the Mothra in the box because the Mothra is flocked, and when Stuss gets in there, she.
One second.
Well, wait. Oh, we got life hacks. What do we got?
We've got a 64 Mothra, which is you can see he's flocked. She's flocked too.
I have her in the. Her in the box.
And she also has a little bit of dust from the bottom, which sucks.
Yeah.
And but this is the acrylic wings and the flocked body and the acrylic eyes. It's a really nice little figure.
Yeah, I love that figure.
It's nice. And then he needs a she needs a clean. I could probably clean that off, but
yeah, I never a little bit of, knew what to really use. I wonder if like just using like a lint roller would work. Like,
I think the dust is sort of ingrained in there.
Yeah, like yeah. So I actually have her in box, but the 92 I don't. And
see, I should have. I might have to pick up a new one of her and keep her in the box because she's jacked up a little bit with the. Because the flocking does pick up every speck of dust.
It picks up everything, yeah. Everything. So. But it's so cool. That's why I love I guess the Batra is the one to definitely take out of the box to show off the acrylic wings.
Yeah.
Because he's just a vinyl figure. Yeah. But the 92 Mothra, what's really cool is they come on a base with a stand and they the stand they're on an angle so you can actually see their wings really nice. I'll have them for part two.
The bases are nice too. So here's the deal, AJ. So at 8:30, we've been talking for 2 hours. So why don't we just not go any further into some new stuff? We'll just continue talking about this stuff and reminisce because we can pick this up. I know people are going to be bored. I mean, more than 2 hours is a long
one
time.
One more thing.
Oh, okay. One more thing.
One more thing. Oh.
That's definitely one more thing. Another
just,
one
just,
I never
just
had.
Just one more thing. Just one little thing here.
Wow. Final premium bad boy.
The super premium.
A super premium
meltdown.
Yeah, super. That's a great figure.
I think we even still have the box in a shed. I'm sure it's destroyed by now. But
wow.
These things came in the biggest boxes of all time. So you very rarely ever even see these available with their original box. But what's really cool about this other than, you know, just being meltdown and amazing is these had, you can see the thing that gets missing a lot on these is the sticker on the bottom. That's not a sticker. That's like a metal plate that's got the number of which one it is.
That's pretty awesome.
So a lot of the times if you see these, they either don't have them because again, it's not engraved in the vinyl. It's literally held by like a very thin like tape. But I mean, this has always been.
Congrats, man. That is one of the coolest Bandai figures ever made. Pretty cool.
Of all time. And then they made the regular version, which, you know, was just the traditional, darkest.
Burning gray. Godzilla, yeah. Diane Dougherty at Clawmark Toys, we actually sold two of them. We had one of each. We had the final premium meltdown, then we had the standard one, right up like opposite sides of each other.
And it also came with, and this was at a four, they made 4,000 of these.
Wow.
And, you know, so it comes with the number of yours. Just really cool.
May I inquire what you paid for that guy?
Dad. We've had.
Ballpark.
Because we got these back in the, I'm probably going to say he was like 800 back then. That sounds about right. If I had a guess. It's worth it.
Oh yeah, it's definitely, I wouldn't have any room to put him. I would have no room to put him.
Well, that's the, I know, I absolutely hate putting figures on the floor, and I've literally always have to put him on. There's, because his tail, as you saw, I don't even think I got him in the full shot. His tail is just
way too insane. Long. Yeah, no, it's crazy.
Funny, so you want to talk about reminiscing. So funny thing about that figure in particular, my best friend, Danny, used to always try to play tricks on me. Like when he'd come over, he tried to like hide figures and see if I would notice. And I always did. I always like, I'm very, my dad will tell you, I put everything in a very specific way and it's not allowed to move. So like when it's moved, even if it's like turned a different way, I'll be like, hey, who touched that?
I know, I do the same way.
Yeah. It's like, no, someone was here. So this figure is massive. So obviously I'm going to notice it's not my, he would hide this in the most obscure places in my house when he would come over. Like,
how do you hide that thing?
I would go in the bathroom and he'd put it in the laundry room and like close the door. So it'd be on top of, he had all the time. I'd like come out and be like, dude, where is he, man? Where'd you do with him? And I'd have to like go hunting around my house, trying to find him.
That's crazy.
I swear. He just always called him the big orange guy. Was that the big orange guy?
The big orange guy. That's exactly what he is. He's the big orange guy. Yeah, that's another one. Like there's a few regrets that I never had in my collection, and that's one of them. There's actually a shop in Seattle's Chinatown in the International District. It's basically a model shop, and there's a really high shelf, and they've got one in there. Has a little sign around its neck or whatever. I think no photos or whatever. And there's like a layer of dust sitting on him. Like he's not even orange anymore. He's like gray because of all the dust on. It's really sad. It's really
yeah. He's
sad.
Like he's got some dust like in the like the spines specifically. I really do got to go back and like give all of these the cleaning they deserve.
You know what works really good to clean these guys? I found, especially if they have the sticky film on them, you take a little bit. There's two ways to do it. If it's not so bad, just get Dawn dishwasher.
Yes.
Because dishwashing liquid that has the grease, it takes the grease out. And if it's really bad, take some of that Goo Gone. Okay, they have it in a spray now. You dilute it with water. So you don't spray the whole thing. You dilute it with water, and then you just kind of take a sponge and you let it sit for a couple hours, and then you just take it outside and you hose it down. Completely takes everything off.
I
and has that nice
that.
Orangey That's, smell.
Sounds like a yes. Lemony fresh
orangey lemony citrus smell.
We got pro tips here. Yeah, I've always used Dawn. Dawn, we've like I'll usually take like a I'll just get like a big bucket and just fill it, and I you know I usually have all the tags in plastic, so I'll hold it by the tag, dunk it, take it out, put it on a towel, let it just hang out.
See, that's why I take the tag. Another reason I take the tags off, so I don't have to worry about the cleaning process. A toothbrush works for small intricate places, and a scrub brush works for the big giant ones. So plastic, not you know, you don't want to have the metal scrub brush that'll scratch them up. But
what's happening? The paint's coming right
off.
Don't
try this at home.
It's a terrible idea, David.
Yes, I know. but yeah, no, it's definitely been a lot of fun talking about this stuff. This is brings me back. It's A lot of people can relate to this these toys, and it got them started, and I agree with you. It is kind of sad that they sort of fell to the wayside when, you know, Marmot, M1, X Plus, you know, Giga Brain, they kind of stole their thunder a little bit. But I think that what we're going to talk about in the next episode. The next segment of this particular show is we're going to talk about the newest one, the Bandai Premium line, which basically they really upped their game. They're smaller, but they're almost up to X Plus realism.
Very highly detailed.
Really highly detailed, and you know, there's a lot of you know people think they're pretty expensive for the size and everything, but I got to say I'm not disappointed with any of them so far.
I'm one of those people. Again, we'll get more into this, but especially I get it for the Ghidras, and I definitely get it for the 3 Mechagodzilla pack.
Right.
I'm very, very skeptical on this Jet Jaguar release.
Yeah.
Because there's not much there, and it's like, it's basically going to be like almost over $200 when you, I mean, if EMS never comes back, it's going to be like $250 or whatever.
So we can dive deeper into this, of course, in the next show, but I thought the same thing until we actually really like did a little research on it. And basically you're getting two figures because the flying jet Jaguar is huge.
Yes,
it's actually bigger than the other one. So if it was one figure with, you know, different arms and accessories, then I would 100% agree with you. But since it's getting two complete figures, still expensive.
I just wish give, make him 9 inches. I guess that's like my, if he was 9 inches, I wouldn't even blink. I'd be like, let's do this. Right. When it's like 7.5, I'm like, right out of the gate. It's kind of like the X Plus Kong Skullcrawler set.
Yeah, that's a little. Yeah.
It's like I have no problem when, you know, stuff becomes unavailable and you have to go secondary market and you want it. You know, you can determine what you want to pay for anything. Out of the gate, I kind of have issues with. I'm like, I don't know if I'm paying five. What was that? The Kong set.
Like that's five, a lot of money.
Yeah, it's like over five, like right out of the gate. It's like, I don't know about that. We have a question that we got from Matt Buzz. What's up, man? Do you gentlemen have a favorite Bandai Theater exclusive?
Favorite theater exclusive. Yeah, probably. I think.
Yeah, I'll show you my dad's. The original Bandai Theater exclusive. Ah, there he is. Yes.
Probably this guy. Just really, really great figure. And this is almost, it's very similar to the X Plus release that they did in the solid orange vinyl. This one actually has more nuance to it. It's got like the vinyl's painted on the inside too, like just like the other one. And it's semi-translucent, so you can kind of see through it. And I just like it because the eyes and the teeth are painted. I don't like when they don't paint the eyes and the teeth. And this is a really, really fantastic one. It's a nice big size.
Yeah. Isn't that the first Godzilla theater issue? Is that one, isn't it?
Isn't
Destroyer the first time they did it?
I think that's true. Destroyer in the chat room.
The first time they ever did it, because the Forever set obviously wasn't a theater exclusive. So I think that is the first Godzilla theater exclusive. People are actually asking if we're going to talk about theater exclusives. Most of those, a lot of them came in the 6-inch line, which we're going to do another segment covering the second half of Bandai, so to speak. But since you want to see some exclusive stuff, a little tease for our next.
Yeah, show them a tease.
So I don't know if everyone's familiar with some of these boys.
Is that your favorite?
Pearl and Crystal Godzilla? Yes. I have to say, I always forget which is which. I think the Pearl is without tag and came with like a book sheet, which is this one. I love this one because like this one kind of yellowed up a little bit. You can kind of see it. Like it's not as clear. Whatever they used on this one, and this is...
That's the way to go, yeah.
This is just unbelievable. As for theater exclusives, we're going to cover that more again, cause there's a lot more of them in the 6-inch line. And then we're kind of stopping around like 95 for Destroyer in terms of Bandai for now. Cause again, we didn't want to have a 4 to 5 hour show. So we'll definitely touch up. And then here's another,
that's a great one.
Very rare. This was a lottery piece. I believe it's a red glitter. Final Wars guy again.
That's super cool. I like that one a lot.
Yeah, this one's fantastic. So so we're going to cover the 6-inch. There's a little tease for you. We're also going to cover, before we get into Bandai Premium, there was another venture before that, and that was the Bandai Museum series.
Yes, that's right. That's
so
correct.
That will be on the next. This is one of my personal favorites. Anytime there's a Gorosaurus of any kind, I'm all over it. And then, do you have a premium to tease?
I don't. I'm going to have to get those out of the box because I've got a lot of my 6-inch premium stuff in a bin. So I'm going to have to dig those out for the next show. So I do not have one to tease. But
do you have the Mechagodzilla?
Premium. I'm sorry.
Premium, yes.
Oh yes. All right. So let's show you.
I was like, wait a minute. I think you do.
Sorry. I'm
look at that thing. Oh my goodness.
Look at that glitter. Look at that, those glitter pants.
Yeah, I cannot. I have that set in I'm waiting for EMS to come back. I just recently got a box because I got tired of waiting, and I was just, the price was just, I was like, what is this? I can't.
Yeah, you gotta wait.
Yeah, I mean, like,
so I actually didn't get the entire set, AJ. I think you heard this story before. I was gonna pass on it because of the cost, but my buddies, James Hartman and John Bumpus, my roommates from G-Fest, the three of us kind of wanted to have one. So we all figured out which one in the set that we wanted to have. So we bought one set and just kind of split it up. So we each have one representation of it. So
that's awesome.
That was a pretty cool way to have it. And I definitely wanted one that was half transforming one. And they were all happy. John wanted the straight up Mechagodzilla, and James wanted the full on, you know, glittery ones.
Actually, Will from the Godzilla Files, we had brought it up on one of the live discussions I did with Leslie and the crew over there, and he was like, "Nah, man, you gotta get it because they're gonna do the fake Godzillas, and you have to put them all in a row." And I was like, "Yeah, you're right. I do have to do that. That's so." I went hunting and lucked out and got it before, because now, I mean, I've seen that guy go for a lot now, the full set.
Oh yeah, the full sets. It's the secondary market is these things are definitely not losing value. And
no, well, and that's good. It's like, you know, I want to see Bandai kind of come back.
Me too.
Not even just from a retail auction show standpoint, but just from a collector standpoint. I'll give you one more tease.
So they did a 54, right?
Yes.
Brown vinyl. And I did keep the tag on him. I just kept the tag on him. Nice.
Do they all
really
come
cool
with
tags.
Tags attached or no?
They do. Every single one comes with a tag attached. Hmm. Yes. So it's a really fantastic sculpt, very realistic, looks just like the 54. Wouldn't it be cool if this was just the first in the whole line? They did every single Godzilla. 55, 62, 64.
Yep. One of my favorite things about the 6-inch line is the 50th anniversary set, which
we'll talk about.
I agree. If they did that, I think everyone would be all in. I think everyone, especially because they'd be all new, if they're all in that kind of quality where they just look amazing like that.
This one is like a morph between like an X Plus figure and a Bandai figure. It's that good. It's like really, really well done. And it's really hard vinyl. It's not super soft. Not terribly poseable at all, but that's okay.
Then he has one stance anyway.
He has one stance. I mean, yeah. What are you going to do with this guy anyway? Just a really
good night, Dad.
Very, very impressed with that set. So. Anyway, we should probably call it a night too because it's been about 2 hours.
Yeah, actually, it's exactly been 2 hours. Look at that.
Perfect.
Favorite Bandai Mania? No.
Gotta be the OG. Gotta be the OG.
I would go with the Final Wars one just because at least it looks good.
The OG, man.
But, I mean, before we go, again. Just to plug my own stuff here.
Oh, we've almost forgot about him. Roman.
He's now in stock, everybody. I will be doing a review on this and the regular deluxe version. I am so happy to call, like, honestly, the cool, not even, you know, the fact I worked with Brian and Sean on this and we came up with this concept all kind of together and really took off. This thing is tremendous, by the way. So, you know, here's your standard 8-inch, you know, 62 is a pretty big Bandai. New. Big beefy boy. And was so cool. So I'll definitely be doing a full review. But honestly, the thing that like blows my mind, that we've been able to do this, and thank you everyone that supports us. Just having the header card with our logo on it.
That's super. Like, that's great, man.
It blows my mind. Like I can't even get over it. Like this is one of 50. This one's mine. This is gonna hold a special place in my B movie heart. With the, if anyone's ever even seen this movie, just watch it. It's or watch the Mystery Science 3000 version of it at least, because that's actually
that's probably the way to go.
Yeah, that's actually where I discovered it. But still, such a cool design, and the skull head is glow in the dark, which Brian hand painted. He did a fantastic job. So I just want to shout that out. It's in the store, kaijulive.shop. Very happy. Our first of possibly many exclusives to come.
Very cool.
We'll see.
Very
we'll
nice.
See what the future holds.
So real quick, I'm going to give a plug too. So this coming Saturday, August 29th. What day is Saturday? Anyway, this coming Saturday, we're doing a special episode of Collect All Monsters, kind of a roundtable chat, and we have a couple special guests, and we're going to talk about toy buying and collecting in Japan.
That's going to be a great
one.
So
if anybody is interested in you know, where the shops are and how you go about doing it and just fun stuff like that, we're going to talk about our experiences with toy shopping in Japan.
I'll have to download that one and keep it forever, because I yes. never been to Japan, so I'll use that as my guide whenever I finally get to go.
It's going to be a fun episode, and so it's 3 p.m. Pacific time and 6 p.m. Eastern time, so please check it out. It's not going to be a normal show. It's probably going to be shorter, but it is a roundtable discussion about toy shopping in Japan, so please check it out. See you there.
So definitely, if you like Kaiju Live, definitely subscribe to Collect All Monsters. And if you haven't subscribed to us and have been watching this, please subscribe. All right, everybody. Have a great night. Thank you so much for tuning in. And at some
point,
we will get part two going maybe in the next 2 weeks or so. We'll figure out when we got some free time. So everybody, like and subscribe and be on the lookout for more content from Kaiju Live. Good night, David.
Thanks, AJ.
Anytime, man.
Good night. Nakuna pokuramo.